have this great turnout tonight. We are here to hear from all of you. Many of us, or you have been interacting with us quite a bit by phone call and emails, and now we want to hear from you here tonight. So the format tonight is we primarily want to hear from people who are in our districts, because some people have been shipping people in from outside the districts, and really...
You make decisions for the whole state. You affect the whole state, so don't do that.
Okay, listen.
You make decisions that affect the whole state, and I do it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, just go ahead.
That's fair.
Besides, we parked the bus out back. You couldn't have seen it.
As I was saying, our intent is to hear from our constituents. So when you raise your hand, I'd like people from our respective districts to be the people that we get questions from initially, and then we can move on to, it doesn't work if people talk at the same time. Did someone say so? I can't hear you if I'm talking.
Yeah, I'll repeat.
Okay, can you wait until we have a question?
Sure.
This will work better if people speak and listen. We have to do both. So the intent is to hear from people in our districts. So when it's your turn, when we ask you for a question, please identify yourself. Just say where you're from and then go ahead and fire away. So I'll give it over to Representative Hinson for some opening comments.
Yeah. Thank you very much for coming today. How many of you are my constituents, just so I have an idea? Awesome. Okay, great. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Ashley Hinson. I'm a new representative. I've been in office about, 45 days, so I appreciate you all coming. I serve on the Appropriations Committee. I am the Vice Chair of Appropriations, which means we'll have a lot of lifting to do here when we get our budget numbers set in the next couple of weeks. We're actually working on developing our budget targets right now, getting those all figured out for all of our different departments and then sub-budgets, which will then determine our ultimate spending for the year. I also serve on the Transportation Committee. I've run a couple of bills already through that committee. Those are what we call, for the most part, they're non-controversial bills. So we've had some good things there, very bipartisan things. In fact, one of the bills that I ran this week on the floor passed with a 98-0 vote. Two people just didn't vote. So that's a lot of what you don't hear about are the positive bills like that that are good policy. Obviously, I know a lot of you are here because of the more contentious issues, so I thank you for coming, and that's why I'm here too. I want to hear what you have to say. I'm also serving on the Judiciary Committee this year. Ken and I both are on that committee, and I'm on the International Relations Committee, and we have already welcomed several different international delegations, including from the Czech Republic and from Kosovo already, as well as a delegation visiting from China. And Chinese students who are students at Cornell College in Mount Vernon. So we have had a busy session already. I'm thrilled to be here and to take your questions. And I'll turn it over to Ken for opening.
Yes, so I am the chair of the State Government Committee. I also serve on Judiciary and a couple other committees. Some of the big things that I've been working on, we have a constitutional amendment that would amend the Iowa Constitution to add electronic communications and data to those things that are protected against unreasonable search and seizure. So you'd have to have a warrant in order to access somebody's emails or to access their electronic files. That passed unanimously out of the Judiciary Committee. Last year it passed the House unanimously, so I'm anticipating that that will pass in the Senate. If you're going to amend the Constitution like that, it's got to pass two General Assemblies, so it's going to have to pass in the next one, and then it would actually go to a vote of the people. Some of the other bills I've been working on, one was a synthetic drug bill that I've been working on here for several years. Synthetic drugs are a huge problem in our state and across the nation. Lately, there has been a great increase in synthetic opioid use, and what this bill does is there's a problem with current law in that every year we change the law to add a number of compounds to the code that would be illegal and be considered a synthetic drug. The problem is the manufacturers of these poisons change the compounds faster than we can change the code. It's kind of like computer viruses. You know, they're always kind of one step ahead. And so what this law does, it takes some language from Florida that's been used very effectively, which says if it looks like a synthetic drug, if it gets you high like a synthetic drug, if it's hidden behind the counter and you have to say a special code to have them bring it out, if it's marketed like a synthetic drug, then it can be treated like an imitation controlled substance. And I know there's at least one person here who's family has been very negatively impacted by synthetic drugs, so I'm hopeful that will get through. In state government, we've got a couple major bills. One that we passed this week was a big alcohol reform bill. For years, you've had wineries, brew pubs, and distilleries that have been trying to grow. Young people are tending to favor those now over some of the more traditional alcohol drinks of the past, but they've been kind of held down because they haven't been able to sell their products on site, and there have been other restrictions on their growth. So we had a major effort, compromise between all the key stakeholders, and we passed a bill that will allow like Cedar Ridge Winery and Distillery to actually sell by the drink, which it never made sense that you couldn't go out there and get a glass of their bourbon when it was produced right there, but it was actually against the law. So that's coming through. Next big thing, and I'm sure we'll have a chance to talk about this tonight, is the Voter Integrity and Modernization Act. You may know it as Voter ID, and we'll have an opportunity to talk about that, but that's gonna come through my committee, and I'm actually gonna be the one that's gonna run that. First subcommittee on that is Monday, and then there's another big bill coming through my committee. The governor dropped a bill that is it's going to reform licensure, boards and commissions, and we have gotten just enormous feedback on that bill. And
that bill could very well cost me my life.
Shut the hell up until we're done.
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say anything. What, you know, the crazy thing is, for those who are against this bill, what I was just going to say is, we've listened, and we're basically not going to run the bill. We're going to kill the bill. So,
thank you.
So anyway, I think that's probably enough for introductory things. So at this point, is there anybody that has a question?
Yeah, we have. Okay.
Okay.
At least start off with from the list so we can go from there.
Let's start. Well, Mark, you're in the front row. You're on the page. Go ahead.
Yeah, stand up, identify yourself, and speak really loud so everybody can hear.
All right. Well, my name's Mark Bussell. I'm from Marion, and I was going to ask about HSB 138, the license bill.
Mm-hmm.
But since it sounds like that's going to get killed.
Can I tell you what we're intending to do on that?
Sure.
Or do you have another? Okay, so the question was about this licensure bill. What it was going to do, it was going to eliminate licensure for all kinds of professions across the state. There are many of us who think that Iowa has too much licensure compared to a lot of states. The data shows that. But the bill went way too far, particularly in areas of health care. And it, you know, when you're talking about people's health, you gotta ensure that it's safe and secure. So what we're going to do is we're gonna kill that bill. We're gonna introduce another bill that's gonna create an interim study committee to look at licensure, kind of like what we did with alcohol. And so you don't have to stay standing if you don't want to. So anyway, we're going to look at it. We're going to slow the process down and do it in a more rational and thoughtful way. Do you have something else?
Well, there's still some questions that I have. So just as a background, I'm licensed myself, not in anything that y'all are dealing with, but I'm a senior reactor operator at the nuclear plant here. We're licensed and we have to have oversight and regulation because of, obviously, for health and safety of the public.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to have anything bad that happens that's going to affect everybody here. The issue that I was having with with this bill, and I hope that when we do have this study and it does come back as another bill, anything that's going to be affecting the health and safety of the public needs to be licensed. It needs to have regulation and oversight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so my question was going to be like some just yes or no for both of you, because you're the chair of the committee and you're my representative.
Yes.
So
yes.
Do you feel that mental health workers should be licensed to treat patients?
I absolutely believe that mental health workers should be licensed.
Okay.
Me too.
Absolutely. And something we're looking at in this, there's a thing called certificate of need. And I don't know if people know what that means, but that means if there were a mental health provider who wanted to open a mental health clinic, they have to get essentially permission from the government based on the needs of the community to open that facility. And we have seen across the state there have been some issues, particularly in mental health, where there was someone who wanted to open such a facility, and we desperately need that kind of care. And because of the certificate of need issue, they were unable to do that. So we're going to address that there and try to pull back certificate of need when it comes to mental health, because mental health issues are growing across the state. Our prisons are too often serving as the first place that's giving the people the mental health care mm-hmm. they need, and we've got to do something.
Yeah. I'll piggyback a little bit on that. Mental health, how many of you care about that issue specifically? Okay, good. One of the other bills that I think is going to be very, very important that's going to come through the House. Louder? Louder. All right. excuse me. One of the things that I think is really, really important that we're trying to do with mental health is we have a 9-county region right now here in eastern Iowa that we're a part of here in Linn County. Not every county levies at the same rate for the property taxes to pay for those mental health services. Here in Linn County, obviously, we provide a lot of services to people, but we are not able to levy at the same amount as Johnson County is. Johnson County is levying at about $22, I believe it is, per capita. We're about $10 more than that per person. So there's a bill that would come through that would help equalize that a little bit in terms of which counties need to be contributing more to the pot to pay for all of these services. There are obviously some counties that use fewer than Linn County does, and we need to make sure that we're being level-headed in who pays what for these services as well. So that's a bill that will come through that will help make sure that we have the proper funding and that we can apply it as such in Linn County specifically.
Yeah, can I piggyback on that? So I'm a Republican. I believe in low taxes, but this is actually an area where I support increasing the levy for mental health, because as Ashley said, the levy rate is different across the state, and those counties that have opted in at a lower rate are stuck. They can't move their levy rate up to where it is in other counties. So what happens is, in these mental health regions, you have some counties that are essentially subsidizing the mental health care for the counties that have the lower levy rate. So we have had counties come to us and say, please let us raise our levy rate to the same rate as some of these other counties. I see Supervisor Olson here. He and others from Linn County have lobbied us pretty hard to try to solve that. And that's something I'm actually very, very much committed mm-hmm. to doing.
Okay.
Looks like Jill Stutler.
Yeah.
From Rizer.
Deborah Berry? Okay.
First off, I want to talk about IPERS, because I have something to do with that. So I'm the chair of state government. Any reform to IPERS or any other state pension system has to go through state government. I have pledged we're not going to touch IPERS this year, and we're not. Let me finish. Let me finish. So here's, we're looking at IFRS because IFRS is about 85% funded. So there's a big unfunded liability. It is one of the best run programs in the entire nation, though. So the last thing we want to do is mess that up. So I will make an announcement right here. And that is, if we're doing IFRS reform, I believe we have to grandfather everybody who's currently in the system. If we're going to reform it in any way, if we're...
Let him answer the question.
If we're going to have to do some sort of reform, I think that should only be for new employees. Because we want it to last for, I mean, forever. We want it to last for our lifetime. So that's IFRS.
Well,
because it's not fully funded. There's an unfunded liability. Go ahead.
So I was just going to say, to kind of spin off of that, I understand what you're saying, that it's, at 80, it's currently about 84% solvency. But for the 2016 study, it will be 100% solvent in 28 years. And I understand 28 years is a long time, but that doesn't sound like something that you should just throw out the window altogether. And yeah. I understand you wanting to grandfather folks in, but what incentives are there for Iowans to go into education and stay in our
I don't want to. Sure. No, I agree. And I think that what you say is very, very important in terms of looking at it with the 37,000 foot view. We need to be very cognizant of the fact that if we are going to examine a program, and that's just saying examine, you know, from my perspective, I would, my father's a financial advisor. He manages money for a living, and that's what he does. And I've had many conversations with him about the state plan here in Iowa. It is a well-run plan. So I think if we are going to have discussions about that, that needs to come into the conversation as well, that it's well-run. If we're looking at the unfunded part or the unfunded liabilities going forward, that's a completely different conversation, and that may be part of the reform without touching the actual program itself. It may be in how we approach the funding from the state side of it as well. But I think that's a conversation that definitely needs to happen because we don't want to end up, well, it's, you said how many years is it, 28 years. So if we're even if we're looking 28 years down the road, that's with the way things are right now, and that could change, and so we need to be cognizant of that as well as we take that into consideration.
Yeah. Okay, but you talked about schools and teachers. So here are a couple things. All four of my kids have gone to public school. Every single one has gone to WASH. When I got out of the service in 2012, we'd lived all over the world and all over the country. I'd seen every place. I moved back to the Cedar Rapids, Washington district because I wanted our three youngest kids to all go through one high school. Okay, so public education is really important to me. My youngest daughter is at the University of Northern Iowa studying to be an elementary school teacher. She just started her practicum in her freshman year and she loves it and she's gonna be awesome. And I couldn't be more proud of her. I think she's gonna be just absolutely fabulous. I keep in touch with my third grade teacher. She had a huge impact on my life. And she's still like one of my biggest cheerleaders. So education is important to me. We're gonna disagree about the collective bargaining, but I will tell you where I came from on that, and I posted it online. You can go to Facebook, you can look at it. If you wanna shoot holes in it, go for it. But the reason I wanted that bill, the reason I voted for that bill, is because I've met with all your superintendents many, 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 many times. And when I talked to superintendents, they told me the system isn't working. And here's why. Please let me finish. I mean, if you want to, we can argue, but please let me finish. I'm a pretty thoughtful guy. I don't do things, you know, off the cuff. I think about this stuff. It's important to me. I did an analysis of the last 44 years of school funding in the state of Iowa because I get in to the legislature in 2014 and I was kind of tired of being told, you Republicans are cutting education when I'm voting for increases every year and I'm like, why are they saying we're cutting? No, it's not. So what I did is I did this analysis. So here's what the data shows. For 44 years, the inflation rate, if this is 1973 and this is 2017, the inflation rate has gone just like this, okay? Funding for K-12 has followed that curve exactly, but it's been about 0.5% above. So we have vastly increased, in real terms, spending on education since the 70s. We have. The data shows it. The data shows it. But here's the problem, and here's why the system doesn't work. It doesn't work because the state could give an increase. I have voted for $315 million in increases over the last 3 years, which is well above the inflation rate. And yet, the Cedar Rapids School District cuts elementary Spanish. We're cutting teachers. Why? If we're giving more money every single year to schools, why are we cutting? And here's why. It's a math problem. The reason is the state gives an increase. It could be 1%, it could be 2, it could be 6. But no matter what the state gives in an increase, we go into collective bargaining. And the union takes that and they negotiate, because under the old law they could do this, for 1 or sometimes 2% more than the state was giving, which was already an increase. Now, if I'm Brad Buck and I'm the superintendent, and you're probably figuring out I'm a little passionate about this issue, if I'm the superintendent and 80 to 85% of my budget is in that collective bargaining agreement, you can't survive if the state's giving you more every year, but then you're collectively bargaining 1 or 2% above that. So then they end up cutting teachers, they end up cutting programs. And then what happens is they come back and then they say that I should probably stop.
I just want to say that I understand when you're using Cedar Rapids as an example, there are one school district in your area. Is mm-hmm. that true for all superintendents of all
schools? The Community School District superintendent spoke to us today and said that he disagrees with you. Mm-hmm. Today he spoke to our staff and said that that the plan's unsustainable, that your plan's unsustainable, and that he called it the craziest bill he'd seen. He doesn't agree.
John Spear said that?
Yeah, John Spear.
John Spear says the craziest thing
he's
ever.
John Spear spoke to our teacher. I'm a teacher at Prairie.
Okay.
He spoke to us today and said he disagreed with you. You can't say that every superintendent agrees, but we were spoken to today, like earlier today in our professional development, and the first thing he's saying cut is professional development and teacher training.
Okay.
Well,
all I know is I have talked to all the superintendents, including John Spear, and they have said the way we fund schools is unsustainable, and that under this. Do you want to address it?
No. Okay. So I live next door to a teacher. My mother was an art teacher and a guidance counselor. So education's. What? Just a minute. Okay. That's right. So my mother was a teacher, and I've had a lot of conversations. She was a member of the union as well when she was a teacher. And I have had regular conversations with my neighbor, who literally I was texting her as all these changes were happening. I was texting with her and keeping her in the loop. And I think the biggest feedback that I got from her was the fear that's associated with this change. Let me just speak to that a little bit, because I have had conversations with not only the teachers, but the school board members, who I encourage you also to reach out to and communicate with regularly, as well as the administrators and the superintendents, as Ken mentioned. I talked to two of them today, two of the superintendents today. We are in regular conversation with them, not just about this issue, but about every education issue coming down the pipeline, because that is important, and that is a two-way communication street. So what I will say about the fear that I know you all have, and I get it, and I've heard from a lot of you, and that's why you're all here, right? I mean, you're here to express that to us, and I appreciate that. And the conversations that I've had with the superintendents are, why would they have an incentive to make it tough for you to do your job, or tougher to do your job? You have a tough job already, and I know that. I have he turns 6 tomorrow, my son, and he's in public school as well. I'm a product of Iowa's public school system as well. And so let me just speak to the fear a little bit. I encourage you to continue to have those dialogues with your superintendents individually. They want to hear from you outside of, I know you have union stewards and you have representatives on your behalf, but reach out to them individually as well. You have the power to do that, to take control of your own destiny as well, and learn about what they're planning to do.
We don't really do that in our
when we made phone calls, when we sent emails, and didn't get any responses from you. So it's really hard to say, keep doing that, because when we do that and we're not listened to and we are not followed up on, democracy is dead.
I can talk a little bit about that too. I was inundated with phone calls. I was listed on an email blast that went out urging people to prank call me. It did make it tough for me to get back
Why
to people.
Were you at the Capitol when we were all there?
I was. What night was that?
What night was
well,
that?
Well, I mean, during the hearing. I was. Yeah. What?
When the whole rotunda was full of public sector workers, where were you two?
I was
right
watching
I was right outside the public hearing, meeting with people continually.
We were there.
No, I was right there.
He was.
I was right there. I was.
Were you, Ms.
Hinson? I was upstairs watching the.
You were upstairs.
I was, but. No. No. Well, either way, I would encourage you to continue those conversations. Every conversation I've had with them has been that why would they take everything away? Because they know they want to keep you and reward you if you're doing a good job.
But you don't.
Can I add something to that? So that bill moved a bunch of things from mandatory collective bargaining into permissive, which allows John Spear can collectively bargain with your union, and he can give you the same settlement you got last year. He can give you 3.5%. He can give you whatever you guys can come up with. He has the authority to do that. But he also, because we changed the arbitration rules, he's got a little more leverage to try to control costs, which ultimately, I believe, is going to give John Spear and all the school district superintendents more money to hire more teachers, to hire more reading specialists. I talked to this first grade teacher who said to me, I am totally flustered because the district has made all these cuts and changes. We're sharing mental health people. We're sharing reading specialists. She said, I need help right now. And what I'm trying to do is create more money, make it more available so we can hire more teachers and get class sizes down. Because the way we were doing it before, it was not working.
Can I
respond to what John Spear said?
Sure.
John Spear told us it was going to be years before we could hire another teacher. That we were going to have a pay freeze, that we weren't going to be able to hire a new teacher. And furthermore, if we look at Wisconsin, in the metro of Milwaukee alone, 700 teachers left after Act 10 was passed. And we're trying to keep the staff we have in a growing district that happens to have Kirkwood and ADM that we can tax. What about small schools that don't have that? What about the schools that don't have huge taxable income that we can draw? John Spear is looking out for us, and I really respect him because I think he is going to keep our jobs in spite of your bill. But what about the smaller schools? What about the schools that can't survive? My mom, she's teaching in a consolidated school.
What about the teachers that have to fund their own classrooms?
Go ahead.
One of the things that's missing here is the fact that the budget that you have here basically is going is not sufficient to meet the needs of all of these other programs. All the programs are being cut. You list all of them along the way, and they're all going to get cut a certain amount of money. The only answer to that is, and I know everybody's going to go boo, but somebody's going to have to increase some taxes some way to make this.
So you were talking about how can we make more money available? What can we do for the school districts? Well, here's some things we're going to do. We're going to pass home rule, which has been something in the Iowa House we've tried to pass for years. And what that does is it gives the school districts a lot more authority to be entrepreneurial and create unique programs to meet our kids' needs. Iowa Big in the Cedar Rapids School District is a great example of those kinds of creative things.
Shut that program first.
But so anyway, we're going to let the school districts have more authority. We're also going to make it so that school districts have a lot more flexibility with the money we give them. Because right now, the money comes down and it's in these different buckets. And there are rules associated with all these buckets. So if your school district, college community, uses all of bucket one, bucket two could be halfway full, but they can't touch it because of the rules.
We're going to try to create more flexibility so that the districts can use that money the way they see it's necessary. Another thing, the SAVE, one penny tax, which goes to school infrastructure. You know, Governor Branstad wanted to tie that to water quality. We're not going to do that. We want to advance it and leave it so it's specific to help for school infrastructure. And the last thing I would say is we want to give school districts a lot more authority as to how they use money to address educational inequities. So I heard in the back, someone said something about rural school districts. The biggest problem in rural school districts right now is transportation. But there is no money set aside for transportation, and they can't move money between these buckets to cover it. We've got to address that. In the urban districts where I live, it's a little different. There are issues of addressing underprivileged kids and reading issues, lots of other issues. And we want to give the districts the authority to deal with these issues in a unique and district-oriented, kid-oriented way.
And which one of those things will attract new teachers to the district? I'm 27, and I love my job to death. I love my district. I'm honored to work in my district. I am looking for other employment. I have another teacher that during our meeting today, I kind of joked about it, she opened up her backpack and pulled out an LSAT prep book. She's 1 year in. You should be trying to cater to young teachers like me to make us want to join the state of Iowa as a teacher. Right now, Minnesota doesn't look so bad right now.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Can I address the ESAs and vouchers? Because I know you brought that up. I mentioned my child's in public school. Both my children will be public school students. I talked about this. How many of you were at the League of Women Voters Forum last week? So, okay, so you probably have heard this. For everybody who's already heard this, I apologize. For everybody new, I am concerned about the cost of doing something like that. Not just in terms of real dollars, but to the schools as well. And I think that we would be remiss to do a program like that. I do think it would hurt our public school system. I think it would gut it. So the estimated cost for that, I believe if you did a straight program, it would be between $180 million and $200 million, which I have the numbers in the budget. That is not going to work. So we don't have. Yeah, I don't think it's going to come forward this year. I will vote against it. Yeah.
And Mr. Yes. Rizer?
I am for educational choice. No, I am. I am. Well.
Choice is good.
There'll be no choice.
No.
Unless you have
the public. So when I was base commander at Andrews Air Force Base, we were in an area. We were in an area that wasn't as blessed as we are in Iowa with our public schools.
Let him answer.
Please let the man talk.
All right. What I was going to say is we actually worked with the local school district. We created a charter school on the base. 25% of the kids were kids from off base. Most of them were minority children selected by, at random. And that school ended up being incredibly effective. And it actually increased standards across the whole school district. So I think if you're careful about how you do it, you don't want to bust the budget. You don't want to go to a statewide voucher program. But if you allow educational choice, I think it helps. I sat on the floor of the Iowa House and saw people who were trying to shoot holes in these online academies that we have in Iowa. And there are lots of kids in this state who do very well using an online academy. Sometimes it's because, and I've worked with people with disabilities, sometimes it's because of that, sometimes it's because of other things. I think we have to provide educational choices that match the kids in a cost-effective way. So, can we go over here for a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
First of all, I'd like to thank both of you for being willing to face
We have to do this.
Yeah.
You are our bosses, so.
I appreciate that. What I believe is a fundamental issue, though, is a foundational disagreement about how we approach education in Iowa. My father was an educator with the Cedar Rapids School District for 40 years, and this problem has always existed between those who want to cut the budget and not charge those who are benefiting the most from a quality educational system in our state. Those that benefit the most from having the very best education in our state are our largest employers and corporations. And unless we turn to them for footing the bill for some of the quality education and talent they are demanding from our state, we are fooling ourselves. We must look to our major employers and corporations for stepping up. Instead of funding elections that silence this majority. We're giving back what they're taking out of our community.
Can I address that really quick, actually? You look at the contingent liabilities report in the state of Iowa, it does look at the tax credit situation, which I do think we do need to be looking at in this state. I campaigned on that, and I think that's very important. I do believe there are tax credits that are given out that are not doing what they were intended to do. There was actually an amendment to, we ran a bill earlier this year. There was an amendment that would have required a review and thorough review of all the tax credits in the state. I didn't vote for the amendment then simply because it was not germane to the bill we were voting on, but I do support that close and in-depth analysis of our tax credit program, because I don't think we should be giving out tax credits piecemeal across the state. Well, I don't think so. And so I think, and one of the first things that we passed out of the gate, and I don't think we've debated it yet on the floor, but it requires a 5-year review of every single program in the state, because I do think that we need to be making sure that they're your tax dollars and they need to be spent well. And if it's a program that's not working right, gosh darn it, it needs to go. If it's a program that's doing well, you betcha it should remain funded. And that's my passion, is making sure that we're spending money where we need to and not wasting it where we shouldn't be wasting it.
You want to go on the list?
Yeah, okay, sure.
It's Linda Custer, I believe, from Cedar Rapids, Representative Hinson's constituent.
Thank you.
Yes.
I live in Ms. Hinson's district. I want to let everyone know I'm not a public employee. I am not employed in education. But like you, Mr. Rizer, I chose as an adult to live here and raise my 3 children here because of the quality of the schools. I came from another state. And I have really grave concerns about our state's commitment to education. A lot of people here are passionate about K-12, so am I. But I'm not going to talk about that. I think others have already expressed that opinion. I'd like to make a point about higher education. You know, it's education is the foundation of all of our prosperity in the future. And young Iowans can't buy homes, they can't start families, they can't give to our charities, they can't start businesses. My youngest is at Iowa, and he wants to start a business, and he doesn't know if he can because of the loan debt he'll have when he graduates. They're handcuffed to these loans. And not everyone has the wherewithal to save, you know, through the years to completely finance it without loans.
Mm-hmm.
He was a Heritage Scholarship recipient, which just got cut. It's very important to the family that he has that. My husband's deceased. I'm a widow, and we needed that money. And he deserves that money. He's doing well at school. He's got a great grade point. Now, I know you didn't decide to cut the scholarship money. That's an administrative decision, which I will be taking up with the administration over at Iowa. I'm an Iowa grad myself. But I would like to know, why are they cutting funding to the Regents Institution? Why has that been getting cut over the years? What are your opinions on making college education affordable? Our employers want educated people. Our communities want educated people. It's the foundation of our democracy and our citizenry to have an educated citizen. So we have to make it affordable, and we can't make it go to college. You spend the next 30 years of your life paying it off. So I'd like to know what your perspective is on this, funding to our region's institutions, and also if you could make one cut somewhere else, because I know it's not an unlimited budget. You know, we've had problems in the state lately. But if you could cut one thing in order to fund education maybe in general or higher education specifically, What would you personally like to see cut?
Yeah, go ahead. You start. Okay. I'll go ahead.
So I have two kids in college right now, and next year I'll have three. So the cost of college is something that's near and dear to my heart. The state was in a difficult position because revenues, which are projected by this nonpartisan group that we have to base our budget on, they thought we were going to have $117 million more this year than we ended up having. So when we came in January, we were in a difficult position in that we had to find $117 million in cuts. And no one likes doing that. I mean, we had all passed that budget. I had voted for that budget. I didn't want to have to cut anything. But we had to live within our means. So what we did right from the get-go is we said K-12 is off the table. We're not going to touch K-12. We said Medicaid is off the table. Those are the two biggest chunks of the budget. They make up, I don't know, what, 80% of the budget. So now we're down to 20% of the budget. We have to cut up $117 million. So the regents were going to have a share of that. What the governor proposed had a significantly higher cut to the regents and to the community colleges than those of us in the Iowa House thought we could support.
He proposed, I think, $25 million.
And we're like, there is no, that's too much. And same with the community colleges. Because the community colleges are training our workers to fill this skilled worker gap. So we worked with the Senate, we worked with the governor. No one liked cutting, but we had what we thought was a deal. And part of that deal was the regents told us we can take this cut and not affect students. Well, when we heard about the scholarships being cut for next year, no one was more angry about that than us. Because that was not part of the deal.
And
well,
you.
And obviously, and you, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've heard yet, but there's more that happened today in that regard for higher education. And we are not happy about it because we feel like it was contrary to what our understanding was on that budget agreement. Mm-hmm.
So, I think if,
what are you gonna do?
And you know, obviously we're at this stage in 2017, the Revenue Estimating Conference is gonna meet again in March. Usually that's the early part of March that they'll meet. We're starting, as I mentioned, to set our budget targets for 18, but we are also being realistic that there's a very real possibility we could face another shortfall again when they make that estimate in March.
So what's causing the revenue to drop?
What?
What's causing the revenue to drop?
A number of things. I think right now the economy is growing at, I think the rate is about 4% right now. And I believe that the one of the biggest things is that the farm revenues are down. A lot of the farmers are paying their taxes right now.
A third.
Yeah.
From where they were.
Yeah. So, and that's, and if you look at the data for the last 2 to 3 years, it's not just corn and soybeans, it's also cattle and hogs. So we are, obviously here in Linn County, we're very urban where we are right now, but if you look at the state as a whole, a lot of our income and the revenue comes from farms, and it is down. That said, I think it's positive to say that it is still growing, so that's a good sign in that our economy hasn't slowed or recessed from that. That said, I do think that we still need to be cautious going forward. And so I am facing the very real possibility that the REC is going to come back and say, you guys are below where you should be again for 17.
Yeah.
And if that's the case, then we need to maybe look at the economic fund.
Here's another issue. We don't do zero-based budgeting. So whatever we put in the budget for last year, that becomes the base for the next year. It just rolls over. And when you do budgeting like that, you end up having all of these built-ins that are already in the system. And so this year we started with $200 million in new revenue. And that sounds like a lot.
$195.9 million, actually.
Okay, she's on appropriation. $200 million in new revenue. But when you take out some of those built-ins, and then we increase K-12 spending by $40 million, we're down to $110 million that we could use for increases to other parts of government. That sounds like a lot of money, but it's not. And the thing is, over the last 6 years or so, the judicial branch has gotten static budgets. public safety has gotten static budgets. We're down like 100 state troopers from where we're supposed to be. So you're not going to like me saying this, but some of the things you've seen with collective bargaining are there to try to get control of our budget, because right now we have very little flexibility.
Yeah. Why didn't you campaign on that? Yeah. What kind of raises have you gotten over the last 4 or 5 years?
Well, can I address it?
Yeah, I'd like to know.
Okay, so the legislature's gotten zip. And not only did we get zip, but when we did the big budget cut of $117 million, what we did is we cut our per diem and cut the session by 10 days because we felt like we needed to lead by example.
What about the governor?
Yeah. Governor makes $130,000.
What about his pension?
When I was at Goodwill of the Heartland, just as an example, I mean, you're asking these questions, I'm gonna give you a straight answer. I was at Goodwill of the Heartland. It's a big nonprofit, $37 million a year-ish in revenue, and the CEO there makes $150 million. Or 100, no. I'm getting tired. Yeah, she wishes she made that much. No, she makes $150,000. So our governor at $130,000, I mean, you can argue and say that's too much, but he hasn't gotten a raise either.
He's also collecting a
pension. Do you want to go to...
Sure. Well, that's okay.
I have just a quick follow-up, Mr. Rizer.
Yes.
You answered my question, and you said that the main decline in funding is due to the agricultural production. Commodity prices have fallen. Mm-hmm. So that makes sense, right? Affects your budget.
Right.
Well, that's always true enough. Mm-hmm. And that can be somewhat forecast. So when commodity prices are high, like they were a few years ago, why doesn't the legislature reserve some of them? I've heard this before. It happened before. Rainy day fund. Mm-hmm. Isn't that done? If our budget is that impacted by agricultural prices, then we should have a system in place that when those prices are high, which happens in a cyclical manner, money is stocked away so that when prices are low, we don't have to cut essential services.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's a great point. The emergency fund, if you will, was $900 million like 5 years ago. And it's been depleted to now, I think it's down around $100 million. Again, sounds like a lot of money, but it's not. And we're required, there are two emergency funds, it's not worth getting into all the geekery of this. One of those is so that we can cash flow the government. Because we never want a school district or anybody else in government to be waiting for their money and have to borrow money. So you've got to have a certain amount of money. You can't touch that part. The other one is what some call the surplus or the ending balance. Mm-hmm. And for the first time in a long time, it was down below $100 million, which made that 99% expenditure limit actually kick in to where we couldn't spend, we had to spend less than we were actually taking in. You couldn't spend the surplus by law. So we are required by law to continue to fill up that surplus. And with the budget targets we're looking at for next year, that'll be up to $125 million. But the short answer is, that's been depleted.
Well, why would, you shouldn't have to go like that. It shouldn't.
So is it a bad time for commercial tax cuts? Yeah.
Sure, yeah, I'll touch a little bit. I've been looking at that. That obviously happened before I got into the legislature. And I've been looking at that very closely because, as I mentioned, I do think we need to be looking at all tax credits, tax cuts, tax reform. We need to be having all of those conversations because, realistically, we are backfilling that at $154 million a year. And that is a huge expense. And if I'd have been there, and I obviously wasn't, so it's great to look back with 2020 vision and say what I would have done, but I would have required a sunset on the backfill and made sure that the program was working. Because if you look at the actual commercial property tax growth, Linn County has seen property tax growth in the commercial. That said, it is a big burden to bear by our city. So I do think if we had, I guess if you're looking out in the future, or in my case, looking back at the way things were done, I would have set a sunset on that. If it wasn't working, then I would have liked to see it expire. Yeah. So.
So sunsetting the backfill is just shifting the property taxes to county supervisors in the cities, and you sit here and mandate
all these programs that we have to provide, if you don't provide the money, you're mandating the collective bargaining, you're taking away, you're doing preemption, you're not letting us make any decisions for our locals, and you say you're going to sunset.
I mean the rollback in its entirety. I didn't take any money from them. You can check my report. I'm serious.
Who's next? Dylan, who's next?
Let's not bring that in.
Can we have Laura Bell from Marion?
Laura.
Bell?
Yes, Laura.
I am not actually prepared for a question, but I would like to defer my question to a veteran in the audience. Joe, would you ask the question, please?
Joe. Where's Joe?
I don't see him.
No, right there. Joe, your turn. Yeah. Yes.
I'm a veteran. Joe, would you ask, please?
I have a veteran question, actually. Okay. My name is Chad Willen, 40 years old.
What's your first name?
Chad. 40 years old. I live in Cedar Rapids. I got businesses in three of the four districts. Graduated from Auburn High School in 1994. I had 36 people in my class. Finished third from last. Terrible math. I never went past 10th grade math. Math to me is foreign. No matter how hard I tried to study it, lost. But I was from 9th grade to senior year, I was a national debate champion, never lost nothing. So my grades are A's or F's. And you know, and I had the same at a small school, same teachers, same curriculum, same that. I only focused on the classes that I could do good in. I had to make up for the classes that I knew no matter how hard I tried in math, I was not gonna do good. I needed a D minus to play football. That was my goal. So when I did graduate, I went to the military. Did three tours in the United States Navy.
Thank you.
Came back, got out, and I thought I was ready to get out. This is another part of the question I had to ask about the veteran part. I was ready to get out. They offered me a re-enlistment bonus, a warrant officer program, and you know, I just thought, you know, I did my, at this time I was in 5 years, I was ready to come home and try civilian life, you know, go to school. Got out, did join the reserves, and I right away had started a family, two kids, and unfortunately, you know, where I was at when I joined the reserves was in a place where, you know, a lot of people could go and not sleep for a long time, so some of the stuff you saw. This is post 9/11.
Yeah.
You know, we were prepared for that. You know, that was our training. And I'm not going to say where I was at, but it was bad places. You know, you knew it was bad, but you know, when I got home, I figured this is going to be easy. You know, easy to adjust. Well, I found myself thinking that I was fine. I did some things different that I pulled my kids out of a school when they stopped doing the Pledge of Allegiance. Some people thought that I was insane. I was real patriotic. I was never a violent person, but I was real defensive towards protection for my family.
Yeah.
I wound up in jail 15, 16 times, all on defense charges that, you know, I would do again at that point. When they let me out, that we had 6 months of training. They gave me a 6 month counselor, trying to get, you know, do civilian life, and you don't think you need it.
Down in Iowa City?
Yeah, and I took that when I was still in Jacksonville, Florida.
Okay.
They sent me up to Paris. I was teaching desert survival training at Paris Island on a marine base. Okay. And so I was separating, and I came back. I thought, what I went through, going back to Cedar Rapids, Iowa, is going to be a piece of cake. But, you know, I come back and, you know, at 19 I was working on $40 million F-18s on a flight deck, most dangerous job in the world. Come back, you know, and I'm applying for $12 an hour jobs at this point of my life at 24, and I'm getting passed over on wiring ambulance CB radios by someone that has a 2-year degree at Kirkwood when I'm an aviation electrician on F-18s during wartime. No, you know, school, I mean, it was a dangerous, dangerous place, and you learn under the most, you know, I learned a ton, but you can't kind of relate There's not a lot of F-18s in Cedar Rapids. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But to wire a radio to get passed over a two-year degree, I got into depression. You know, I thought I'm not good enough no more. When they tried to keep me in to re-enlist, the admiral of the ship, I was sailor of the year, brought me up to the top of the flight deck that time. He was trying to talk me in. And then he says, I'm going to try to talk you in, but if you don't want to, he says, well, I says, if I tried, he goes, well, I want you to do one thing. When you go back, your classmates that you graduated with are going to be in college, have their 9-to-5 jobs, probably house, mortgages, and you're going to think you're down. Don't let that get to you. Put your hands on this. And I put my hand on the USS George Washington steering wheel. He says, you're driving the most powerful machine in the world right now. So don't think, let that get you down. And I didn't let that sink in. But when I got back, finding a job for $12 an hour was super, super hard.
Yeah.
The
so Chad,
yeah.
What is your question?
My question is on VA, the VA Medical Center.
Okay.
Okay. I ended up doing well in life. Okay. But I isolated myself. I lost separated from my spouse because of some PTSD I had.
Yeah.
And in my isolation, I could not work with no one else. I stayed in one room. Worked on developing apps when the Android phones came out.
Yeah.
Built myself a little cabin and bought a home in Arizona, and that's what I did. I worked on a contract where I could be by myself, not be bothered, and I could deal with my PTSD on my own way.
Yeah.
Can I
address the VA issue?
Yeah, the VA issue.
Have you had good care at
the
VA?
That's what I'm gonna say. When I went out there, they prescribed me. I went in there and they prescribed me marijuana, which, you know, whatever you're pointing, I didn't use that. I was out there by myself. I was isolated. I was happy. I was working from there, from my phone. I could work from my phone. I didn't like being around people. I just did not like it.
Yeah.
I felt I was a nuisance to them. I really wasn't, but I was having some mental problems. Come back to Iowa. We have an excellent CRV clinic here. Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Yep.
Fabulous. Yep. Fabulous. I have no problem. I have no problem with it. It's one of the best things ever.
Yeah.
But one problem I do have with it is I can afford it. You know, I make enough money. But like 6 months ago, I took a fall.
What do you want me to?
I took a fall, and you know, I took a fall and broke some bones. Yeah. And I used the VA medical center. I figure I went to VA. I like going to VA.
Yeah.
So I had to go to St. Louis. They're closed. Even the Iowa City one's closed. There's no emergency room.
Yeah.
And then I get a bill for $6,700 that I can't turn into the VA. Now, we're less than 1% of the population.
Yeah.
Vets are. And, you know, the teachers that are in here, they're me.
Oh, careful.
Yeah, but you know, but the kids, they got to adjust to what kids learn, the way they learn.
Yeah.
You know, they're teaching us, so I'm going
to
say that.
For the good of everybody here, what would you like me
I would
to
like
talk
to,
about?
I'd like to know why, when we can't go to the St. Luke's and get care, and they can't pass the bill at least to the VA and let them pay for it.
Yeah.
But I get stuck with a $6,700 bill. I can afford that. But other veterans can't.
Yeah. Can I address that?
Yeah. I would like to tell you, and thank you for your service.
Thank you.
That is a hell of a story, and there are lots of veterans just like you who've had sometimes a tough go in the transition back to civilian life based on what they saw in the military. We have not been happy with the treatment a lot of our vets have gotten at the VA. You know, there are the stories of the death lists and the stories of vets going to the VA who are suicidal, need help right now, and they can't get through or they get turned away. These are primarily federal issues, and Senator Joni Ernst is all over it and all over the VA to try to straighten this out. So, a couple other things. The chair of our Veterans Affairs Committee in the Iowa House is a retired Marine drill sergeant named Steve Holt. And he is all over the VA, particularly on this suicide hotline thing. So we're doing what we can to try to intervene there. I'd like to talk to you after to get your name and address, because probably need to put you in touch with either Congressman Blum or Senators Grassley or Ernst because that $6,700 thing doesn't sound right. They passed a bill that said that veterans, if you can't get your treatment at the VA, you have to be able to get that in the civilian world, and you shouldn't have a $6,700 bill.
Yeah, I do.
So that doesn't sound right. So we got to fix that. So get with me after.
And I appreciate taking the time to for that, because now that I did well in life, I hire veterans, and a lot of them aren't going to have that option. Mm-hmm. And I came to Cedar Rapids for a $110 million water park project that we're bringing. And you know, I want to have 85 employees. I'm going to try to hire all veterans. And I just, one thing that I'd like to do is make sure some of those people don't go through that. You know?
I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Are you okay going 15 minutes more?
Oh, yeah. Okay. One quick thing I want to mention about this, too, because I think it's important. I'm not a veteran. Obviously, Ken is, and he can relate better to you probably on that issue than I can. But what I will say is important to me is making sure that people who have served have an easier transition to work. And I think one of the things that we can do to make that easier, we actually had some visitors from the VFW post here in Marion, and they were talking about, if you're trained as an Army medic and you want to get a job as an EMT, you shouldn't have to jump through hoops to do that because you've already got the training, right? So we're talking about ways where we can make it easier. If you can prove that you've already got this training, that you should be able to, you know, I guess it goes back to the licensure issue again, but that you should be able to get that job with the training that you have, or at least have it count toward the full shebang, I guess you'd say. But, you know, like I think we need to be looking at it from that perspective.
On the medical side, real quick.
Yes.
Can we go to somebody else?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, we'll stay after to talk to Sophie. Rhonda, I think.
Sure.
Rhonda, wait. Rhonda's next. Yeah, Rhonda's on the list.
My name is Rhonda Schaus. I'm in Ashley Hinson's district. I was here to talk about House Study Bill 138 as well as the licensure. I would like to go ahead and continue talking about mental health services in the state of Iowa. We're in a crisis that is not a stretch by any means. Crisis is really what we are in. I'm glad to hear that you guys are interested in raising the tax levy. That is something that needs to be done as far as across the counties. I would also like to lobby you to vote for House File 386, which is Jackie's Law.
Okay.
It is because of Iowa's failure with our mental health care system that Jackie and her mother were killed by her son who had schizophrenia and was not treated properly. And we need to make adjustments in the laws that we have now to make sure that people like him, like Michael, can get help in the future, and this is not a problem.
Okay. Thank you, Rhonda. And thank you, Rhonda, for your question. Rhonda has been a great advocate for mental health. I'm sure many of you have seen, you've been in the paper many times, you've come to the Capitol many times. You have personal experience as well as your family with mental health. So I appreciate you speaking up about that. It is very, very important. And we are committed to making sure that we address this issue at the state level. One of the other things that I know is very, very important to you is Medicaid. And I actually just had a meeting with Lieutenant Governor Reynolds yesterday, where I had several doctors approach me about problems with pre-authorization for procedures, because that has been a real problem. And I'm going to be working with their staff to make sure we get that addressed. I mean, there's a lot of other things that we're working on with that as well, but I just wanted to make sure that we connected on that, because I know that that's important to you. And it is something that I've been working on, because we're hearing it a lot, and so we're going to work to take some action on that as well. Yes, yes.
Go over here.
Hi, my name is Sarah Hines. I live in Marion, and you are my representative.
Okay.
First of all, there's something that I want you to speak up, just because it sounds like you have some background. I would like you to tell us about the voter integrity bill.
Okay.
And then I have a question, because I know a little bit about it. I've already read about it. I wrote a letter to Secretary Pate asking him to answer my questions, and he has not yet. But I want to relate it into what we've been talking about tonight. In Iowa, when there's very little voter fraud that can be documented at all in Iowa, it's almost negligible. He wants to update the voter rolls to make them e-rolls, and one voter ID, and says if you do not have a driver's license, that they will send one to your home and that you won't have to pay for it. But that's something very expensive. It almost sounds like a solution that doesn't have a problem. Problems that we've been talking about with funding education and healthcare and other things, how can you support something that would cost so much? So first of all, I'm going to bring up the bill for those who don't know about it, and what entails, and then how can you support it when there's this cost involved?
Sure. Thank you for that question. Okay, so this bill, we started with Secretary of State, Secretary Pate's bill, and then we're going to significantly amend it. And the amendment just came out yesterday. One of the things we were really concerned about is the cost element. The Secretary's bill had us, let me just back up a little bit. So this bill, what it does is it is going to increase the integrity and confidence in our election system, which already is very good, but it's also going to modernize it. And I think there are a lot of people who are really focused on this idea that, well, there isn't much fraud, there isn't much, so why are we even bothering? I like the bill almost more because of the modernization element. People talk about suppressing the vote. If we have really long lines at polls, I think that suppresses the vote. 72 of our 99 counties.
We haven't had long lines because not enough people have been voting.
That's right.
Within your power. We need more. We need more. You're right.
You can open the polling places longer. You can have more early voting. That's within your power.
That's a sad reason.
You can't claim voter long lines voting when it's within your power to fix it.
72 of 99 counties use these e-poll books. And all an e-poll book is, it is a laptop that's got the voter database in it. It also has the felon database in it, so you can check it right on the spot. And what it does is you have a scanner. 95% of you in this room have a DOT-issued scannable ID. It's either a driver's license or it's a non-operator ID. So what you do with this bill, if you go to vote, you're one of those 95%. You hand your driver's license. They scan it. It says who you are. Maybe they ask a confirming question. Hey, what's your birthday? Just make sure you are who you are. And then you go and you get your ballot and you vote. It's as easy as can be, which is why 69% of Iowans in a recent Des Moines Register poll said they like it. Now, the issue is, what do you do with the 5% of people who don't have one of those IDs? Well, every single one of those 5%, they already get a voter registration card, right? They already do. So instead of doing what Secretary Pate wanted to do, which I think was well-intentioned but more expensive, our amendment is actually going to use the current voter registration card that everybody gets, that everybody's comfortable with. We're going to reformat it so the barcode is on the card and not on the attached letter on the perforation. And we're going to give everybody a unique number on there. It's a confidential number. So if you're one of those 5% that doesn't, it's a registered voter, not with one of those DOT-issued IDs, we're going to send you this updated voter registration card. And when you go to vote, if you're one of those 5%,
you'll still be able to vote same day.
All you do is you hand them that, they scan it, and they say, hey, are you so-and-so, is your birthday this? You say, yeah, and you go vote. If you're going to do an absentee ballot, you put that number, or if you're one of those that has a driver's license, you put your driver's license on the absentee ballot request form. It's no big deal. And if you show up and you're a single mom, you got four kids, you're discombobulated, you show up and you left your purse and don't have any ID, you say, I don't have any ID here today. And then no one is turned away. We do a provisional ballot in that case. So this is wildly supported across the state of Iowa. 69% of people say, I mean, if I gotta show my ID to go buy Sudafed, if I go to Walgreens, or if I gotta show my ID to get on an airplane.
That's not a constitutional right, though.
Well, okay, you bring up a good, this is a really good point.
You gotta show ID to get a gun.
Can you stand up and say that?
Yeah, a constitutional right is voting. That's the disenfranchising voters by requiring an ID.
Why are we wasting our time with this? We have so many more important things to do in the state. Isn't it interesting that it's always Republicans who want to pass these voter identification laws? Why are you afraid of democracy? Why are you so afraid of democracy?
You're talking about long lines. How is that going to... Because all I do right now is go in and sign a sheet of paper and I go vote.
Nobody
checks. If we made it mandatory and everybody vote...
And 95% of people, you can scan it.
How is that
can
going
I answer your first question, though?
Sure.
And so you said it's a constitutional right, right? So I look at that as something, we had people that fought and died so we would get that constitutional right. So it's a high value and something we need to make sure that we defend. It's important. Now, people are going to say, and they're right, we don't have widespread voter fraud in the state of Iowa. That's true. We're blessed to be in a state where people are honest, and we just don't have that. But did you know we had 7 felons in Linn County that voted in the last election?
Yeah. I represented 2 of those guys that used their real name. They don't need an identification. The identification wasn't the issue.
Yeah.
They didn't understand that they didn't have to vote.
My point was, the number is in zero. It's not widespread, but a vote is worthy of defending. We don't have a lot of Iowans who are trying to go blow up an airplane, yet we check an ID. We don't have a lot of Iowans trying to blow up or trying to rip off a bank, yet if I go down to Linn Area Credit Union and I want to take money out of my account, I show them an ID.
I had a friend where somebody actually voted in their place. Where did her rights go? Where's her constitutional?
Well, you have a provisional ballot then.
She never got
you
to
get
vote.
You get a provisional ballot. That's
we've
how
got,
that works.
How do you want to go?
Go to we'll give it another 20 minutes.
A lot of problems.
Till 6?
Yes, sir. Same as this.
Okay. All right. Let's. All right. We'll take Joe's.
Joe.
Yes. Can I ask you something?
Colonel Rizer, Joe Stutler. I know that you're not a big fan of mine, and I'm not a fan of yours either. But you are my representative, and so you get to answer to me. And Representative Hinson, kind of the same thing, because you also represent Marion. Mm-hmm. My concern is that House File 295 that most of you are familiar with because of the minimum wage that they're trying to make it difficult for poor people. My concern as a disabled war veteran is that one of the provisions in 295 would strip Marion, the city of Marion, from some of their civil rights provisions in Chapter 31. Specifically, the amendment filed H-1107 took away some of the other nefarious things y'all were trying to do, but still aims at Marion specifically against lawful source of income. In Marion, landlords cannot discriminate against people that get Section 8 disability pay, Social Security, or whatnot. They can't say, we don't like the color of your money, when a lot of times they really mean, we don't like the color of your skin.
So
right
Joe,
now,
what,
Marion
Joe,
says,
Joe,
no, no, no.
Joe,
Colonel Rizer, I'm speaking. I didn't interrupt you.
What is your
I would
question?
Ask, my question?
What is your
is,
question?
I didn't interrupt you, sir. I would ask that you not interrupt me.
You're giving a speech, and this is a quorum. What is your question?
Colonel, I'm getting to the point, and many of you talk far longer than me, so Addie.
All right, so make one round.
I went to war to preserve our rights. I was willing to die for the rights of all of us. I think that if you're going to try and take away rights, you should be willing to shed some blood too. So my question to you is, are you really wanting to fight to take away rights from Iowans when these Iowans, many of us, have actually fought to preserve these rights? If you do pass this, they can discriminate against a disabled veteran, a poor person, a whatever. Why is this even in there, and what are our representatives that represent Marion going to do about it? Marion's already registered against it.
Sure, yeah. Joe,
I
looked at that bill as well, and it gave me pause as well. The way it's written right now, I cannot vote for it. And I'll be frank about that. There's a lot of bills that come through that if you don't like it, okay, you can stomach most of it, you might vote yes. But this is one where the way it's written right now, I could not support it. So I will be frank about that. That doesn't mean it won't be amended going forward. So I will be glad to level with you about my position on it going forward. But as it stands right now, I can't vote for it. And I am one who believed that we should set a statewide minimum wage, and I would be in support of an increase in that wage. But I also think, but I'm just saying the discrimination. Yes, I understand. So as it stands right now with that, because I saw the little lines through it in the bill when I read it, and it made my stomach turn. So as it stands right now, I could not support that bill.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Colonel, are you planning on stripping rights? I would hope not, because you and I serve in the same sandbox.
We did. In fact, did you know what today is?
Yep.
What is it?
26 years ago, I was over there pounding sand. I think this was the start of the ground war.
It was the start of the ground war today, which is why I'm wearing my dinner scarf. Yeah. So I saw that bill. It came out in local government.
Yep.
I am for the preemption element of that because I believe, and I know that's not your issue, but I'm going to talk.
Well, it is because of local control and y'all campaign on that. And well, now you're completely reversing.
Well, no, can I answer the question, Joe? Yeah. I do believe in local control.
I believe that...
So I believe that if a business is operating across county or city lines, that having multiple minimum wages makes it very, very
difficult. Not my question.
Okay, but
minimum wages.
I'm telling you about the bill. That's the main part of the bill. Okay, so I am for having a statewide minimum wage. I'm for the preemption element. I have said publicly many, many times, I would be open to increasing the minimum wage if we could do so and not increase unemployment. Primarily because I used to work with people with disabilities. We used to place them in the community. And if you raise that minimum wage to some of the levels people are talking about, a lot of those people with disabilities who are hanging on and love their jobs are going to lose them, and I'm not going to support that. But the element you're talking about, it went too far. It went too far, which is why I went to the chair of local government and I said, I cannot support this bill the way it is. And that's why there was an amendment. I haven't seen it. It hasn't come to the floor yet. But I honestly don't think the state should be saying that Johnson County or Iowa City can't do plastic bags. I think that's a little too far. Mm-hmm. So I think you have a point. I need to look at what they've amended it to. It hasn't come to the floor yet.
The amendment completely strips out of all of the rest of the local control of civil rights ordinances, with the exception of lawful source of income. So it was written specifically to gut Marion's civil rights statute, to prevent preempt Dubuque, who just voted against it, but could have voted for it. So. This is pretty well aimed. Do the research and stop the attack on our rights.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Joe.
Can I talk about rights for a second?
Okay.
I think Joe brings up a really good point, and I just want to go on record and say that I think rights are important, which is why I don't think anybody should go into the public arena, Facebook or otherwise, and call a state legislator a C. I don't think anybody.
State representative talks to a veteran and says, I'm going to talk to you like you're special because you've gotten TBI.
Please let me finish.
Well, you brought up the conversation.
I don't think it's appropriate for someone to say to a female state representative, I wonder how she'd like it if she were grabbed by the peep. I don't think it's appropriate.
Why is this germane to today?
So I think we're done.
No, it's okay. Yeah. Well.
Okay.
Wait. Well,
all right. You gonna stick around?
Yeah. Let's take one more question because we. I know you're all here. So wait. Let's go on the list. Let's see. Ann Huebner.
Ann
Huebner.
Yeah. Huebner, I'm sorry.
I'm an educator, and I have a question. Actually, you are my representative. Mm-hmm. I have a question for Representative Rizer because of a bill that he proposed to gag educators and making it illegal for us to speak out about educational issues that affect our careers and the lives of the children and families that we serve every day. Please speak to the motivation of those attacks on us and how that is constitutional.
Yeah. I think that's a fair question. So there was a bill, let me back up. When I was in the federal government, it was against the law to use government resources for political purposes. So if you were at work, or if you were using your government computer, your government email, you couldn't send something out saying, I support Donald Trump, or I support Barack Obama. You couldn't engage in political activity with taxpayer resources. That made a lot of sense to me. Well, in the state of Iowa, I have seen in many cases that that isn't the case. The standard is not the same. So I was trying to do a bill that would address that and make it similar. And I made a mistake, because when I asked for that bill, the words were included, political or union activity. I got a lot of feedback from people, and they said, that doesn't make sense, because if you do that, what you're doing is you're essentially gagging legitimate union activity of employees. And I was like, that is not my intent. My intent is to not engage in political activity. So what we did is, initially we were gonna strip union out, and then we essentially killed the bill. So I know there's been a lot that has been sent around saying, Rizer's trying to take away our First Amendment right. That's not true. That was never the intent.
So the bill is officially killed?
That bill is dead.
Oh, and I did not
hear
that.
Yeah. There was another bill that came from the Ethics and Campaign Disclosure Board, which says that you can't use government resources for political activity or lobbying. And I don't know if it's going to make the funnel. But it has nothing to do, it doesn't say anything about unions, and that other bill should never have said anything about unions. So I apologize if that got people spun up.
It specifically said educators, didn't it?
No, it didn't. It said political activity, political and union activity. Mm-hmm. So is that our last?
Yeah.
I have a morality question for you. May I ask?
Okay, and this, sir, we'll make this the last one.
And wait, one quick announcement. Okay. And a quick announcement too. I brought my clerk from. Yep. Just a minute.
What's that?
Okay. That's in a bill that will come through judiciary. So we will look at that. I brought my clerk from Des Moines for the reason that I want to make sure that we get back to everybody who has a question if we didn't get to answer it tonight. So I encourage you to please come up. We're going to write down any questions that you have. If you didn't get it answered tonight, I will get back to you. That's a promise. If you're my constituent, that's my priority, and I want you all to know that, because I'm going to go through constituents first and then get back to everybody else. That's the way I tackle my email and my phone calls. And I think that's fair that I prioritize my people first. So go ahead. Sorry. I'll just make that announcement and then go ahead.
I'm not a paid protester. I drove myself here. I live in the district. You have talked at great length about the words that you were called, which are inappropriate. You've talked about moral issues, about saying the right thing, doing the right thing, standing up for the right thing.
Yeah.
I ask you too, how can you look yourselves in the mirror and vote party lines for all that you do with everything you've talked about every day on TV that comes through? We have everything that he says. It's absolutely appalling. You come up here and you talk to us about doing the right thing, saying the right thing. You chastise us when we don't do that. And every day we get the same thing from your boss.
That's right.
I don't know. We got a question? I don't know.
Sir, anyone who knows me in Des Moines knows I have gone toe-to-toe with the governor and said no on something that he said. I have done the same thing with leadership, and I have voted against my party on several times. Other times, what I do, no, the way I try to do.
Choice of fonts.
Choice of fonts, thanks, Joe. I try to be a leader on these issues. So if I see something that doesn't make sense, I get with the people who are crafting the legislation, and I try to change it in a way that I can support it. So,
yeah. I'll speak to something on that, because there's an issue coming up. And I've only been in office, a month and a half. We have not had a ton of votes yet. So before you judge, just give me my time to vote and then make your decision. Obviously, you will have that choice in 2018. And I know I've heard a lot of you say that. So I'll be very clear. There are issues coming up that I have been very public about my opinion. And those of you who've been at the League of Women Voters know, I don't agree with our state's approach. Many of you know it as Senate File 2. I've been doing a lot of research on women's health care access. That's a passion of mine, and making sure that that is available. I agree, the list that came out, I'm sure many of you saw that, not okay. That list was not good. And from my perspective, if women are going to have access to health care, it needs to be, number one, presented to them in an accessible way. A database, for instance, of all the services that are available, who you go to, where they are, what they cost. I think that that's really, really important. The patients that are affected by this are the poorest patients, the family planning waiver patients. So this bill gives me great pause for the reason that it affects those people. So it would be a big impact on them, and I know that. And so I've been very vocal about I have used Planned Parenthood in the past. I'm a woman. I used them for my Planned Parenthood services 11 years ago when I first moved to town. Now, I had private insurance, so I wasn't a family planning waiver person, but I didn't have the access to an OBGYN that I needed at the time. So I did use them. And so I think preserving women's access to health care, no matter who's providing it, is important. And so as I go forward with that bill, and I have been very vocal about it, I don't see that we should expand our government to do this. So that's my perspective on that bill, specifically. As it stands right now, yes, I would vote no on that bill. But
last question, truly the last question.
By the University of Iowa Graduate Student Union. So that prenatal care saved her life, and I'm grateful for that, and I hope that future graduate students won't be faced with more difficult choices because of the vote. But anyway, I'm gonna get more specific. So my daughter's on the intellectual disability waiver. I found out today, we had a meeting with her case manager, that the case managers that kind of coordinate all the care for disabled kids in Linn County, they're going to be fired. They got a letter this week that they are going to be fired. And so I know there was an oversight bill voted on last week. There was a much more stringent oversight bill that you voted against, and then you chose to vote for an oversight bill with a lot fewer teeth to it. And I'm wondering, with all the issues we've had with the MCOs, with the non-payment, now they're no longer covering ABA for children with autism. I'm wondering, do you regret that vote?
First off, the autism, there's a bill moving, and I think it's going to pass the Iowa House, that is going to make autism one of the things insurance companies have to cover.
For that therapy, specifically.
For that therapy,
yes.
Because it's not currently covered by insurance.
No,
Iowa is in a minority of states, I think, that doesn't have that, and we've got to have it. As far as that... The shift to the MCOs has not been without problems, obviously.
As parents, we tried to tell them that was not going to work, and they didn't listen to us. They just rolled their eyes at us.
Yeah.
And now what a mess you have. What a mess you have.
Yeah. So I know the Human Resources Committee is looking into that. The people who chair that committee and chair the HHS budget sub are on that group that is responsible for the oversight. And so I haven't heard what their report is, how they're gonna tweak it, what they're gonna do with the money, but they're looking at it, because one thing is the cost has continued to go up.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the things was, you know, you're gonna get better quality care at a lower cost, and we haven't seen that.
No.
Okay, so if your point is we need to look into that and try to improve it, I would agree. I'm not ready to throw the baby out with the bathwater, though. I would rather try to fix the current system and make it work.
Branstad kept saying we had to go that direction to save money for the state. Whenever you do something just to save money for the state, where does it go? Because it certainly didn't go toward our handicapped children. And like you say, it is, I think, just from what I read in the papers, that's all I have to go by.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And my daughter's on Medicaid. Yeah. God help her.
Yeah.
We don't.
Yeah. And real quick, just to cap off on that comment, you know, the pre-authorization that I referenced earlier, that is a problem that has happened with the MCOs. And I had, I had a conversation about that as well. I'm a member of the MCO watchdog group. Rhonda started that. And I follow that. I'm notified of those posts every day. So I am on there and paying attention to that and paying attention to the problems that do exist with our Medicaid program. And we are going to be working to fix a lot of those problems as we go forward with that program. So,
all right. Thank you
very much.
I think both of us are going to stick around a little bit.
Thank you.